Good evening and welcome to the first of our series of four talks on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You're most welcome wherever you come from. If you're from the parish of Finchampstead in California, you'll probably know who I am. If you're not, you may not, and so I'll introduce myself. I'm Canon John Edwards. I'm an associate priest in that parish, and it's a pleasure for me to be able to present these talks. The resurrection is the central feature of the Christian faith, and we're going to explore during these sessions what the Bible tells us about the resurrection. These talks are based on some talks that I gave, obviously then in person, some 10 years ago, but they've been brought up to date and abbreviated somewhat for the purposes of these talks this year. The resurrection, as I said, is the critical element of the Christian faith. Paul put it rather bluntly when he was writing to the church at Corinth. In 1 Corinthians 15:17, he wrote, "If Christ has not been raised from the dead, your faith is futile." And we'll try and bear that in mind as we progress through these sessions. Our aim is to look at in detail at the biblical material relating to the resurrection of Jesus, and thereby to deepen our faith in the risen and living Son of God. What we're going to do is to have an in-depth look, first of all, at the four gospel accounts. So this week we'll be looking at Mark and Matthew, next week at Luke and John. In the third talk, I'll turn to Paul, whose writings were earlier than the Gospels, but whose direct information about the resurrection is somewhat sparser than theirs. And so we'll start with the more familiar and move to what Paul certainly concentrated on, which is the implications for Jesus's followers of his resurrection. And then in the final talk, I'll be looking under the general title of Transformation Then, Transformation Now, at why the resurrection is so important, what the resurrection tells us about God, what the resurrection tells us about Jesus and about the church, and why it's so important for us. So I hope you'll find that we bring everything together at that stage. Rather important for these sessions is a document that I've prepared called a synopsis. Synopsis is quite simple. It just shows the accounts from the Gospels and from 1 Corinthians 15 in a columnar form. Here's the first page, and you can see that each sheet is divided into five columns: Mark, Matthew, Luke, John, Paul. And I've tried to align the various elements of each gospel and Paul's letter with the appropriate accounts in the other gospels. That means that if we're looking at an incident which is reported in the four gospels, say for example the women at the tomb on the first Easter day, we can look across the page and see how each gospel writer has reported that event. The synopsis is available on our website, and if you're able to download it and want to print it off, you'll need four sheets of double-sided paper. And if you're going to print it double-sided, you might like to try and align each double-page spread so that you can read straight down the landscape positioning of the pages, but it doesn't really matter, it's all copeable with. The other documents that I'm going to provide is at least one handout for each session, and that, all being well, will be made available in advance of the session itself. And again, it'll come out in the weekly mailing on a Friday evening before the Tuesday of the following week. And for those of you who don't receive the mailing, you should be able to access it on the website at that time. What we'll discover from the synopsis, and we'll see that just by looking at it and seeing the large white areas in many of the columns, is how little direct overlap there is between the gospel accounts. When we're going through, we'll come across quite a few issues of biblical scholarship, questions that have been raised. We'll touch on those where we have to, but I'm keen that we shouldn't be diverted from our overall aim. And as well as comparing and contrasting the accounts, we'll see how embedded they are, because they all are, in each individual gospel itself. And finally, we can't fail to note how minimalist Paul's access, or reporting at least, of facts about the resurrection is. And we'll consider the implications of that. So to set the scene, I'm just going to remind us all of what happened on the first Good Friday, starting with Jesus's arrest in the Garden of Gethsemane the night before. At that point in Matthew and Mark, the disciples flee. Jesus is tried. Peter three times disowns him and denies knowing him. Jesus is condemned to death. He's crucified. The sky turns black, though not in John. The women, and in Luke and John, others attend the execution. Jesus dies, and the temple curtain is torn in two, though again not in John. Matthew alone reports an earthquake at that point. Jesus' body is hurriedly placed in a tomb, which is closed. The women watch the entombment, though once again not in John. And in Matthew alone, a guard is set over the tomb. The day of execution was followed by the Sabbath day, when nothing happened. And so then we're into the first Easter morning and the familiar events of that day. So we start with Mark's Gospel. Mark's Gospel, almost universally considered to have been the first Gospel to be written down. All we have in Mark relating to the events after the resurrection itself are eight verses in chapter 16. Some older Bibles may have further verses, but again, scholars almost entirely agree that verses beyond verse 8 are later additions and mainly simply repeat what's written in the other Gospels. We'll assume, for the purposes of this discussion, that Mark intended to finish his Gospel at verse 8, although to many people it seems a strange place to finish, and it gives scholars a great deal of entertaining discussion to try and decide whether that's what he originally intended or not. There is, of course, that strange conclusion where, after having been told to go and tell the disciples, the women are then told to say nothing to anyone. There are a lot of resonances between those eight verses and what has gone on earlier in Mark's account of Jesus' ministry. I'm going to refer to them. I'm not going to refer to the individual Bible text references. They'll all be on the handout, so that if you want to check any of them out, you can do so. But I should give you enough information so that you know what I'm talking about and why, in my view, these things are significant. So the women were taking spices for anointing Jesus's body. But if we think back, Jesus in his own mind had already been anointed by the woman at Bethany. This was on the first day of the week. That's obviously the third day, counting Good Friday as the first, just as Jesus had said three times to his disciples. It was just after sunrise, not only the earliest possible time on that day, but the contrast of the light of the resurrection with the darkness that occurred on Good Friday is probably significant too. Who is going to roll the stone away? The women saw the stone being rolled into position on Good Friday evening. Now, they become, rather than simply onlookers, the principal actors in the developing drama. They come across a young man dressed in a white robe. And for Mark's readers, that will recall the man dressed in a white linen cloth who ran away naked when Jesus was arrested. He's sitting on the right side in the tomb. The right side was the place of honor as Jesus applied it to himself during his trial. The women were alarmed. A better translation may actually be terrified. Mark uses this dramatic word only twice elsewhere in his gospel, about the disciples at the Transfiguration and about Jesus himself in the Garden of Gethsemane. The young man tells the women that Jesus has risen, or he has been raised. This undoubtedly is the climax of the gospel, and it's the fulfillment of Jesus's own words from earlier on. See the place where they laid him, as it was reported earlier on. Go and tell. This is a remarkable change from Jesus's earlier instructions to silence to those he healed, and sometimes too to the disciples. Go and tell the disciples and Peter. Peter is singled out because he needed to hear after so comprehensively denying Jesus. He is going ahead of you, or before you, into Galilee, as he told you. This also recalls the calling of the first disciples, which took place in Galilee. And so the account is, if you like, coming full circle. The women fled. They were scared, in just the same way that the disciples were scared and fled at Jesus' arrest. Fear is a frequent response to Jesus during his ministry. But why is it that the women were fearful at this point when they hadn't been before? Were they scared by the implications of what they had heard? By their own vulnerability, by their status, by their grief, or simply by the unbelievability of the story? And then they said nothing to anything. The final verse of Mark's Gospel, the final contradiction. We know that the women cannot have been completely silent. Otherwise, no one would ever have heard the good news of the resurrection. So if I were to summarize Mark's testimony about the resurrection and had to put in a sentence what his gospel tells us. I think I'd say the world has been turned upside down. But for those of us with ears to hear, Jesus had predicted that. It's just that no one was expecting it to happen that morning. Jesus, the Messiah, had been obliterated by the power of Rome and the collusion of the Jewish establishment. His male followers had scattered. The faithful women had a body to attend to. And then, well, everyone knows that huge stones don't move of their own accord, but this one seems to have done. Everyone knows that people aren't raised from the dead, but Jesus was. It was God who raised him, confirming that he was the Messiah after all. And it was God who, without precedent in Mark, sent a messenger to proclaim it. And again, without precedent, and for the times almost scandalously and recklessly, God chose as the only recipients directly of that proclamation, three women. And God's plan seems to hang by a thread, as even their faithfulness seems to be overwhelmed by fear. So the gospel comes to an end with an implicit invitation for the reader to provide the sequel, or perhaps also to put himself or herself in the picture. And whatever the sequel is, it must have at least three elements. The disciples will see Jesus, the risen Lord. He will restore them or redeem them, and Peter, and he will lead them or go ahead of them once again. So now we turn to Matthew's Gospel, and Matthew is very fairly closely aligned with Mark and is now considered to be heavily dependent on Mark's Gospel, though, as we'll see, there are significant differences. There is an irony in that until fairly recently, until probably about the turn of the 20th century, Mark's gospel was considered to be inferior to Matthew in almost all respects, and people considered that it was a rather poor abbreviation of Matthew's. Very few people, I think, would hold that opinion today. We'll keep an open mind on whether the differences between Mark and Matthew reflect Matthew's creativity, or a desire by Mark to restrict his account to his view of the essentials. And we'll look at Matthew's account on its own terms. Overall, Matthew seems to want to emphasize certain elements of the resurrection in ways which are distinctive. God has exercised his power to raise Jesus from the dead. For example, the earthquake is a symbol of God's action, as in the Old Testament. The angel is not just there as a messenger, but as one who effects God's will and who reflects his glory. And we might compare what happened to Moses in Exodus 34, and indeed what happened to Jesus at his transfiguration, to give us some simple comparisons. The importance of the women is put beyond question. Not only do they see the earthquake, the angel, and the empty tomb, but they are the first to see the risen Jesus. Peter and the other disciples don't believe them, even after Peter checks out the tomb. But God does not send an earthquake or an angel to persuade them, as he did for the women. By virtue of God's raising him, Jesus is now to be worshipped both by the women immediately and by the male disciples later. The empty tomb is itself a pointer to God's activity, and the elaborate account of the soldiers eliminates the possibility of any human intervention. Note Matthew's editorial comment in chapter 28:15 about circulation of the soldiers' false report, a clear indicator of why the soldiers are so important to him. After the account of the women at the tomb, Matthew has only one appearance by Jesus, the time at which he gives the Great Commission to his disciples. During his earthly ministry, Jesus seemed to focus on the Jewish people, but now he sends his disciples to all the nations, emphasizing the point by commissioning them in Galilee, whose full name was often Galilee of the Gentiles. Matthew ties the post-resurrection story into the rest of his gospel differently from Mark. Mark's spare narrative links in almost every phrase with themes earlier on. A few of these links are retained in Matthew, but he also has other points of contact, particularly with his gospel's opening chapter. The angel as more than simply a messenger, as we saw a moment ago. We'll remember that God brought the child Jesus back from Egypt, a potent symbol to the Jews of exile and suffering. Now he brings him back from death. The women were afraid, as in Mark, but also filled with great joy, just like the wise men had been all those years earlier. The women and the disciples worshipped Jesus, just as the wise men had done. The last great commandment is given on the mountain, repeating the location of the giving of the Ten Commandments to the people of Israel via Moses, and Jesus' teaching about the law in the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus declares that all authority has been given to him, far in excess of the authority the devil had tried to tempt him with. The commission is to all nations, that is, to the Gentiles. Jesus' first appearance, his epiphany, as we call it, in the gospel, is to Gentiles, those wise men again. And the baptism in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit is a fulfillment of John the Baptist's prophecy, again right at the beginning of Jesus' ministry. And contrast the simplicity of that final great commission with Jesus' detailed instructions to the disciples when he first sent them out on their own. After baptism in the commission, teaching is given priority, just as it was when Jesus called the first disciples. I am with you always, Jesus said on the mountain, which takes us back to Emmanuel, God with us, in chapter 1. I am with you always, to the very end of the age. So Matthew's Gospel embraces the whole of salvation history. He started in verse 1 of chapter 1 with Abraham, and he concludes with Jesus' presence with the disciples and with us to the end of time. So again, if I were to try and sum Matthew's Gospel up in a single sentence, it would be God's plan has been fulfilled. Other elements that we've already touched on, as in Mark, so in Matthew, Jesus predicts his resurrection. But Matthew goes further than Mark. The whole narrative, from the birth stories and the wise men to the end of Jesus' ministry, points to the resurrection and what followed from it. In Matthew, God's power is made explicit in the disclosure to the women of what has already happened: the angelic manifestation and proclamation, the earthquake and the moved stone taken all together. Matthew gives the women more prominence even than Mark. They see so much: the earthquake, the stone rolled away, the stupefied soldiers. They see where Jesus' body was laid. Finally, they see Jesus himself and touch him, confirming that the resurrection is about a physical, touchable body, not a spiritual experience. Their involvement comes to a much more conventional end than Mark's "go tell and they said nothing to anyone" conundrum. The soldiers add texture to the story, while their involvement addresses an apparently contemporary issue for Matthew, the writer. But whereas God has raised Jesus from dead, the intervention for the benefit of the women makes the soldiers become like dead men. The soldiers can't account for what happened to them, but neither can the male disciples. The soldiers are transformed temporarily. The disciples will also be transformed, but permanently. And they will have to wait for a time beyond the end of the gospel, during the eternal period when Jesus will be with him. In the meantime, the disciples' faith has fallen short again. The restoration of the disciples and Peter, implicit in Mark, is no more explicit in Matthew, though Jesus' giving to them of the Great Commission implies that he has confidence in them, in spite of everything, and in spite of, with brutal honesty, the doubt that some of them still had about Jesus' resurrection. And while the Great Commission is a suitable and appropriate conclusion to the Gospel, it still leaves open, like the ending of Mark, how the disciples will interpret it and how we, as its readers or hearers, will respond to it. So you might like, before next week, to have a look at the synopsis if you can access it, or if you can't, compare the accounts from Mark's Gospel and from Matthew's Gospel. It's easy to find them because they are in the final chapters of each of those Gospels in your Bible. Have a look at them. Draw some of your own conclusions, perhaps taking advantage of something that I've pointed to. But see how the accounts differ, see how they feel, See what your own questions are, which are quite likely different from mine. Next week, we'll be looking at the two remaining Gospels, Luke and John. And just as a teaser, it's interesting to note that the post-resurrection Gospel accounts got longer the later the Gospels were written down. So, assuming, as is commonly accepted, Luke was written after Matthew, Luke is longer than Matthew in terms of the resurrection, the post-resurrection accounts, and John is much longer than Luke even. So there is something about the way in which the tradition was not only reinterpreted, as we'll hear, but how it was expanded as time went on. I hope you'll have gained something from this evening and that you'll want to come back next week for the second instalment. Thank you.